In other videos, I talked about the cells and chemicals that make functioning in your nervous system possible. Well, in this video, I'm going to focus on the actual anatomical structures of your brain. Keep in mind that this is going to be a general discussion of the brain, and I'm going to avoid some of the more specific topics in order to keep this video focused on the most relevant structures. Let's start by talking about what the brain looks like. When you look at a picture of a brain, there are a couple things that really stand out. The first thing is that the brain doesn't have a smooth surface. There are a lot of folds and indentations. These folds are called gyri, and the indentations are called sulci. The reason why these exist is because the surface of your brain is really valuable real estate, and your brain has to make the most use of the limited space that it has. An interesting correlation to this actually exists in real estate. So, I live in Florida. Obviously, some of the most valuable real estate is waterfront property. If you look at a map of beachfront communities, you see something really interesting. There are tons of little canals and indentations. These aren't natural. They were created by developers because it creates more waterfront property. I think this is a neat little similarity to the brain structure. The other thing that you notice when you look at the brain is that there is a really long, deep indentation that separates the left and right sides to the brain. It's known as the hemispheres, the left and right hemispheres. The deep indentation is called the longitudinal fissure, and it runs from the front of your brain all the way through to the back. It doesn't completely separate the brain, though. If you look deeper, you will see where the two hemispheres are actually connected with a thick band of connective tissue called the corpus callosum, which allows the two hemispheres to connect with one another. One really neat thing about the brain is that the left hemisphere of your brain is responsible for the right side of your body, and the right hemisphere is responsible for the left side of your body. This is called lateralization. If you were to cut into the brain, you will see the outermost part of your brain has a different color. The outermost surface of the brain appears gray in color because it's composed largely of gray matter. As you move in deeper from the surface, that transitions into white matter. The gray matter is largely composed of dendrites and cell bodies of neurons, and the white matter is the axons connecting in towards the brain. Since most of these axons, the neurons, are myelinated, they have a different appearance. As we move on, we look at how the brain is composed. Think of your brain as being similar to an onion. There are many different layers to it. These layers fall into three main categories: the forebrain, which is the outermost part of the brain, the midbrain, and then the hindbrain, which is the innermost part of the brain. I'm going to describe the brain going from the outermost parts to the innermost. As I do that, keep two things in mind. The outermost is the most recent, both in terms of evolutionary perspective and also in terms of how it develops in each individual person over their life. It is also the most humanistic and advanced part of your brain. As we move in, we go into more animalistic parts of your brain and older parts that are responsible for our basic survival. The forebrain is the largest and outermost part of our brain. It consists of the cerebral cortex, or cerebrum, which is the surface part of your brain. However, it also includes some structures that lie below the surface, like the thalamus, the hypothalamus, and the limbic system. Let's start by talking about the cerebral cortex. The cerebral cortex consists of four parts, or lobes. Although there are four lobes, keep in mind that each has a left and a right, depending on which hemisphere it's located in. The four lobes of the cerebral cortex are the frontal, parietal, temporal, and occipital. The individual lobes have certain functions that they are responsible for, and located within them are also areas that have additional responsibilities and functions. These areas are known as a cortex for singular, or a cortices for plural. There are numerous cortices in the cerebral cortex, but I'm only going to discuss some of the more important ones in this video. Starting with the forebrain, which is located at the front of the cerebral cortex, it plays a role in reasoning, motor control, higher order emotions, and some aspects of language. All the way at the front of the frontal lobe, just behind the forehead, is the prefrontal cortex. This is the most advanced, humanistic part of our brain and is responsible for higher level cognitive functioning. It plays a role in abstract thinking, planning, hypothetical reasoning, and other advanced cognitive functions. The prefrontal cortex is actually the last part of your brain to fully mature, and many people are surprised to hear that this doesn't completely happen until roughly the mid to late 20s. In fact, this is one of the reasons to explain why some adolescents and younger adults may engage in more reckless behaviors than do older adults. The frontal lobe also contains the motor cortex, which plays a role in planning and coordinating movement. Also located in the frontal lobe, in the left frontal lobe, is Broca's area, which plays an important role in the production of speech. Moving up to the top of your brain and back a little bit, we have the parietal lobe. Its primary role is in processing information from the body's senses. This is mostly done in the somatosensory cortex, which receives information dealing with things like touch, pain, and temperature. The neural pathways for this sensory information is located on specific parts of the somatosensory cortex, somewhat the same way your body is arranged. So you can see that the top of the cortex actually corresponds to the bottom of the body. And generally, as we move down the cortex, we're moving up our body. The amount of space devoted to each body part in the cortex also corresponds to how many nerves connect to that part of the body, rather than the actual body part size itself. So things like your legs and midsection have less space than smaller body parts like your tongue, eyes, and hands. The temporal lobe is located on either side of your head, just in from your ears. It's associated with hearing, emotion, and some aspects of language. It's where our auditory cortex is located, and it's responsible for processing auditory information, so our hearing. The left temporal lobe is also the location of Wernicke's area. So Wernicke's area is the counterpart to Broca's area, which is located in the frontal lobe. Where Broca's area is responsible for speech production, Wernicke's area is responsible for speech comprehension. So the ability to understand what is spoken. The final lobe we're going to talk about is the occipital lobe. The occipital lobe is a little weird because it's located all the way in the back of your brain, yet it's responsible for processing visual information because it's the location of the primary visual cortex. Visual information goes from your eyes through your brain to the primary visual cortex in your occipital lobe. From there, it goes on to be further processed in parts of the frontal lobe or the parietal lobe, depending on the information that's being processed. Just like the right hemisphere of your brain controls the left side of your body, the same thing occurs with your visual pathways. The left eye goes to the right occipital lobe and vice versa. A good trick to remember that the occipital lobe is responsible for vision is that there are two eyes right in the name. See? Yeah, I know, it's kind of dumb, but I guarantee you'll definitely remember the occipital lobe is responsible for vision now. The forebrain doesn't just consist of the cerebral cortex, but structures located underneath it also. When we peel back the cerebral cortex, we find first a large structure called the thalamus. The thalamus is sort of like the grand central station of your brain. This is where all sensory information goes through and is able to be connected with all other parts of the brain too. I like to think of the thalamus as being like a really big airport, like maybe the airport in Atlanta. Oftentimes, it doesn't matter where you're flying to, you still have to connect through Atlanta. That's pretty much similar to the thalamus. Located below the thalamus is the hypothalamus. The hypothalamus is strongly connected with your endocrine system and plays a critical role in regulating homeostasis. So basically, the regulating of hormones, neurotransmitters, and bodily functions in order to maintain proper health. This is particularly important with things like sleep regulation. Located below both of these structures is the limbic system. The limbic system has the primary role of processing emotions and memory. Keep in mind, though, that many parts of your brain are responsible for emotions. With the limbic system, we're talking about what I call raw emotions. The two main structures I want you to know in the limbic system are the amygdala and the hippocampus. The amygdala plays a role in strong emotional responses, especially involving things like fear and anger. This is different from emotions that may be processed in the cerebral cortex by the temporal or frontal lobes. The way I like to explain it is that if somebody cuts me off in traffic, I may get mad and angry, but that's going to be different from, say, the way I would react if I were walking down the street and some random stranger walks up to me and spits in my face. A situation like that is when you just react. You respond without even really thinking about it. That type of emotional response is what the amygdala is responsible for. It's located right next to the hippocampus, which plays a critical role in memory formation. A well-known way to remember what the hippocampus does is the saying that if you saw a hippo on campus, you'd remember it. Because the amygdala and hippocampus are located next to one another, this also explains why events that are particularly stressful, traumatic, or highly emotional tend to be remembered more clearly than events that aren't. Continuing our journey towards the older central part of the brain, we go into the midbrain. Remember that the deeper we go into the brain, the more we go into structures responsible for more basic functions. It includes a lot of different structures with specific functions. For example, we have things like the reticular formation that helps us regulate sleep patterns and overall levels of alertness and arousal. Two other structures of the midbrain, the substantia nigra and the ventral tegmental area, are critical in the production of the neurotransmitter dopamine. For this reason, I like to think of the midbrain as being the area of your brain responsible for getting you to do the basic things you need to do for your own survival or for the overall survival of the species. So things like eating, sleeping, and sexual reproduction. The last three structures we're going to discuss are all part of the hindbrain. They are the cerebellum, the pons, and the medulla. The cerebellum is located at the back of your head, just below the occipital lobe. Its name means little brain, and it has one of the highest concentrations of neural pathways and nerve endings than anywhere in your brain. It's especially important for control of muscles, tendons, joints, regulating movement, motor skills, balance, and even coordination. Excessive alcohol use can especially impact the cerebellum, which kind of explains why someone who is drunk tends to be so unbalanced and uncoordinated. Located in the front of the cerebellum, just below the midbrain, is the pons. The pons plays a role in regulating brain activity during sleep and is especially active while dreaming. Just below the pons, where the spinal cord meets the brain, is the medulla, which is the most important part of your brain. The medulla is responsible for critical, life-sustaining processing of the autonomic nervous system. Functions like breathing, heart rate, blood pressure are regulated from the medulla. So if something happens to your medulla, you're pretty much unable to live. One thing I want you to keep in mind is that although I talked about the specific functions of different parts of your brain, there is virtually no function you engage in that doesn't involve the interconnected activity of many parts of your brain working together. Just think for a second how even the most basic and simple tasks of our nervous system involve multiple different parts of your brain and body. Thanks for watching, everybody.